Hello and welcome to episode 2 of Adulting with Autism.
That's right, we have had at least 2 people say they enjoyed it, so we're doing another one.
Makes it about twice as popular as my previous attempt at a podcast, so I feel we're onto a winner.
I don't know, I think twice zero is still zero, so it's infinitely more popular.
Infinitely more popular, yes. But, you know, I still think there's room for a podcast where you discuss potatoes and time. The concept, not the seasoning.
Although potatoes and thyme is delicious.
That is quite
true. It wouldn't be my go-to, but it does go very well.
You know what's this good? Sage.
Oh, bit of rosemary.
Mm. But that is not what we do here at Adulting with Autism. We give advice on how to adult with autism.
But I mean, that could involve cooking.
Yeah, potentially.
It won't this time, but it could do in the future.
My advice this week is, if in doubt, use sage. For any situation.
Yeah. I mean, except maybe, like, cake.
Yeah, maybe don't use sage on cake. Unless you want to, but I will judge you.
Should we do the first question?
I think we should.
Okay. Okay, so first one is, I think, our only non-anonymous one. It's from, I'm going to guess how to say your username, Tekka Hart, who asks, I have a fidget cube, but I'm on a computer a lot using both hands, so I resort to chewing the inside of my mouth because it feels so nice and makes an interesting, but is it bad to do? Like, I made a weird indentation on one side of my mouth that rests well between my teeth where my jaw is a bit more slack. Should I invest in a chew necklace? I mean, short answer, yes.
Yeah.
Because if you chew the inside of your mouth all the time, you are at risk of mouth ulcers, as I know from experience. And mouth ulcers are not fun. They hurt.
They do. I mean, yeah. Don't chew the thing that you used to chew is a good rule of thumb.
So you're against meta-chewing?
I am against meta-chewing in all of its forms, I have to say. I mean, it's not a stance I expected to have to make clear, but that's where I am. That's what I believe.
Okay, so in terms of where you can get chew necklaces, there's probably multiple ones, but one that I know a lot of people like is Stimtastic, which is run by an autistic person, and the money goes to autistic stuff. And you know that the necklace is made of something that's safe to chew, which is a big thing, because a lot of people end up chewing things that are not a good thing to chew, like they might fall apart or contain something toxic.
Yeah.
So definitely invest in a chewing necklace.
Like a poisonous cheek.
What?
I don't know.
Okay.
But yeah, you gave some...
Chew a stim necklace. A chewing necklace and not a poisonous cheek.
Yeah. I mean, that's the one thing I could think of that's worse than chewing a cheek.
Toes.
Okay, yeah, that's also worse. But before we work out all the things that are bad to chew, I think we should tackle the next question.
Okay. Okay, this is a long one. But the gist is, this person is 19... has only been in one relationship, which was short and terrible, and is just generally struggling with trying to get into a romantic relationship and is worried about being the phrase they used is alone forever. So I mean, I just want to start by saying that 19 is really young.
Yeah, that's...
you've got a lot of time.
Yeah, you have many time, much time, and I'm gonna say fairly confidently you probably won't be alone forever. There's a...
Yeah, I mean, certainly my own experience is it's a lot easier to get into a relationship when you're not looking to do so.
Yep, all the best things just sort of occur.
I mean, when I met Nick, I was in that place. I was 19. I had had 2 relationships in my life, both of which were terrible. And I'd basically given up on the idea of ever ending up actually with someone. I'd resigned myself to this. And then I met Nick.
Yeah. And yeah, the thing is, it's I know it can be difficult sometimes. You can get lonely and really feel the need to have someone else there, and it can be a comfort. But I think the best thing to do when you're in that sort of place is find a new interest, new kind of outlet, something new socially, or just something you do on your own, and just kind of, I guess, distract yourself from that those kinds of worries, and yeah, chances are something's going to come along.
Yeah, the important thing is to just, be in social situations is the key thing.
Yeah, and
Which I know can be difficult,
even if
but
it's talking to people online or something like that, you just
And you've met people online, haven't you, Nick?
yeah, it's just gone pretty well on the whole. So yeah, just I know it's tough, but hang in there. And the important thing is sometimes, yeah, you can feel like you don't necessarily have the social skills, or you're not that much of an extrovert. But then you meet somebody else like that eventually, and that's when you can really relax, because you go, yeah, I'm not good at people.
And then you complain to them about lack of spring rolls and info dump about pre-Norman feudalism, and eventually you get engaged.
Bada bing, bada boom. Okay, that's hopefully something like that will happen. Fingers crossed.
Just substitute for your own interests and lack of food.
Yeah.
Okay, we're getting through these quite quickly, I think, actually.
I think we are. Should we have some kind of I don't know, I feel like I should play some kind of interlude. Do we have a word from our sponsors?
Yes. This episode is apparently sponsored by my phone, which keeps making noises.
It does keep making noises.
It's a pretty good phone, it's a Samsung something.
Yeah. We don't receive any money from Samsung, but if we did, that'd be nice.
I mean, they'd probably want more information than it's a Samsung something.
Probably, yeah. If you're Samsung and you're listening, we would like some money.
Maybe a free phone?
Yeah, one of the two. Or both. Whatever you're feeling like. Yeah.
Also brought to you by the letter E.
Yeah. That's a good letter. It's one of my faves. It's in my top 26.
Okay, I'm gonna read the next question.
Good plan.
Okay, this one is also anonymous. Hi, my brother has autism and I was wonder how I could help him. Thanks. Okay, you've given us nothing to work with here.
Well, I'm
Maybe
gonna.
ask your brother?
Yeah, and unfortunately, because you haven't given us enough information, I don't think I can really speculate without possibly leading you astray. So instead, I'm just gonna have to riff relentlessly until I come up with a quality goof. So
Or
thanks. Or.
we could say the best thing you can do as the sibling of an autistic person is not to speak over them and to find out from them what is useful for them. Because every autistic person is different, so the way to help them is to find out from them how you can help them specifically.
That wasn't a goof, that was legit advice.
I'm very sorry.
You always do this. You always say constructive things on this podcast, which is probably good because that's what we're trying to do.
You say always, this is episode 2.
Well, I feel like we're an institution.
As I do goof sometimes, I declared a vendetta on numbers.
You did declare a vendetta on numbers. Remember that, listeners? I think the show was better in those days. It sort of jumped the shark a bit. Change of showrunners, revolving cast members.
Yeah, I mean, I've been played by 3 people this episode alone.
Yeah, it's been really, really distracting, to be honest. All those all the changes.
We're in quite a small room, so it's disruptive if nothing else.
Yeah, moving the furniture around and it's just but you know, I'm a professional, the show must go on. So, yeah, that's the best advice we can really give. Talk. Maybe, you know, read up on the National Autistic Society website or ASAN for more general information. Those two are good bets for good information on how to help. And apart from that, yeah, all you can really do is listen to what they have to say, listen to their concerns. And maybe one good thing is to, if there's somebody who has a lot of problem with sensory issues and may go nonverbal or have meltdowns and things like that, it may be good to look for those sort of signs that they're not doing okay, that they are, you know, being a bit overwhelmed, and maybe work out a way between you to kind of say, okay, you know, let's step outside, you know, or yeah, try and work out something like that. That can be a really good help.
And also, just don't be that autism sibling TM.
Yeah.
That thinks they know everything about autism because they have a brother who's autistic.
Yeah.
Because those people are the worst.
Yeah.
Especially because, as we repeatedly say, everyone with autism is different.
Yeah. I feel like
if you've met an autistic person, you've met an autistic person.
That is very true. I got high hopes for you and on because, you know, you said, I need advice on autism, so you went to ask two autistic people. So that's a good sign.
But like we said, ask your brother as well.
Yeah. Ask us and
your
brother.
That's our main piece of advice. Ask your brother.
Yeah. Me, you, their brother. I think that's the sort of, we're the trinity. We are the triumvirate of your brother's life. So consult the three of us when you need to any kind of brotherly advice.
Yeah. I mean, we're both siblings.
Yeah, we have them. Sibrinos.
Okay. I think that went well. Hopefully you will be a benefit to your brother instead of annoying or anything like that.
Yeah. Yeah. Is open.
Yeah. I think this next one's more for you, Nick, because
okay.
I am the worst at dating, as you probably know.
Oh no, you've done okay.
I feel like I don't really know how to have relationships with people online. Oh, sorry, not romantically. I always accidentally say the wrong thing and people get angry, even people in the autism community. How do I work on not getting so worked up? I'm still going to pass this one over to you, Nick.
Okay. Ooh, that's a tricky one. I mean, because there could be a whole lot of reasons why, you know, people are getting upset. Could be discussing contentious issues, or it could be a simple problem with tact, which I find is often an issue in these situations. Well, I guess if it's the former, you know, it can be, sometimes people will just get their, you know, you'll say something and you'll get their passions going. People have strong views on things and the world
not
is...
Not on Tumblr, surely.
Apparently so. And it can be easy for things to get polarized. I mean, there's a place for debates and discussion, but sometimes you know, sometimes it's hard to see when somebody's inviting you to have a sort of philosophy seminar sort of discussion with them, and when they're more interested in inventing about an issue. Because I often find there's a bit of a misunderstanding there can lead to serious arguments. If somebody says, "Oh, I'm really annoyed about this," it's not always the best idea to say, well, in my worldview, this isn't a problem. It's not not the best way to make friends. But that might not be the issue. It could just be occasionally, you know, accidentally saying the wrong thing, and I think we all do that from time to time. I guess.
Well, I mean, it's part of being autistic, really, isn't it? Just having terrible social skills.
Yeah, sometimes that's gonna happen. I find is being quick with an apology does help. I'll trying to say sorry, that was a bit thoughtless of me, things like that.
I mean, one thing I've noticed some people do, certainly when talking on Tumblr, is will start out a conversation saying, you know, I'm autistic, I might get things wrong, tell me.
Yeah, it's not ideal having to preface social interactions with that, but it can make things a little bit easier. Like, people who know me well expect that, yeah, sometimes I'm gonna be a little bit different or not say the right thing.
I mean, when we started dating, pretty much the first thing you said to me was, I'm autistic.
Yeah.
So that I would know maybe things would be a bit odd or a bit different.
Yeah. One thing I find is, I mean, this may be an odd way of doing things, but I pick up things from films and TV, just what I used to when I was younger, looking at you know, characters, say a scene where characters care for each other and help each other out. Not using that as a blueprint all the time, but sometimes just seeing, you know, nice wholesome content kind of helped when I was a kid. Just people hugging and being nice in Disney movies
or
whatever.
It's scripting, isn't it?
This
is, I understand intellectually that this is how I should interact with people, so I will attempt to emulate that.
Yeah, so developing scripts can really, really help. Just sometimes saying, if somebody's upset about something, just sometimes saying, I'm sorry, that sucks. That's sometimes when that is all that the person wants to hear. Like, that sucks, would you like a hug?
Unless they're upset at something you've done.
Yeah.
In which case, that sucks is probably the worst thing you can say.
No. Yeah, it's, so if you've done something wrong, the best thing to say is, I'm sorry.
How can I do better?
Yeah, how can I do better? And if it's a general thing that's sucking in their life, it's always good to say, you know, I'm sorry, that sucks. That's a difficult situation. Do you want a hug? Or, like,
is there anything I can do?
Anything I can do. These are definite good things to say. And yeah, I hope that you managed to develop some scripts or something like that for these situations, because it is difficult, because, you know, I think one of the biggest obstacles is you can come across as not caring about people, or, you know, being disinterested in their lives if you're autistic, when the opposite is true, I find. You know.
Or sometimes you're genuinely not interested, but you need to be polite, and you don't know how to do that.
That is difficult, yeah. You can, either way, you can come across as a bit cold when you don't want to. But, yeah, I hope that we gave some helpful tips there. You can find something that works for you.
So, we've got a couple of questions left in the inbox, but we're coming up to about the length of the last one, and I want to try and keep lengths consistent.
Yeah.
So I figure we'll answer those ones on the blog, those last two.
Yes. Your questions will be answered shortly. Do keep them...
You'll probably get your answer before the ones that were answered on the podcast, because that's going up tomorrow.
Yes. So basically, keep sending your questions in. We love getting them.
And remember that you can always say, I don't want this answering on the podcast. I want this answering privately. I want this doing on Tumblr.
Yeah, whatever works for you. And yeah, we're just really interested in making adulting with autism friendly and accessible and open to anyone, really. We hope that we've helped answer your queries, whether it's about diagnosis or day-to-day coping. And it's been really nice having positive feedback about the blog and about the podcast.
Mm.
It's really encouraging, and it makes us want to keep doing it.
And after the feedback from the first one, we will be posting transcripts on the same day that the podcast goes up in future.
Yeah. If you have any more suggestions, do feel free to send them in.
Yeah, we're all about accessibility.
Absolutely, 100%. There's no real point in running a disability-themed thing if you don't make it accessible. Otherwise, it just defeats the whole point.
A little bit.
Yeah.
So we'll be back again in a couple of weeks with some more questions and answers.
Yep. Both questions and answers.
Are you going to call them dear listeners again?
Maybe. Because they are very dear to my heart.
That's nice.
Yeah, I like them. They're my pals. They're my special podcast pals.
Okay.
Goodbye, special podcast pals. Until next time.